Devils captain Nico Hischier ties this game, sends it to overtime, and Dawson Mercer scores his second goal of the night in order to give the Devils a huge 4-3 overtime victory against the LA Kings. Welcome into your post-game show presented by Genucel. I'm Catherine Bogart. Let's take a look at all the action as the number three team in the West faces the number three team in the East, and it's another chance for the Devils to get back on track after a previous loss. Early in this one, a great chance by Jack Hughes, and minutes later, Dawson Mercer has another great opportunity as well. 7.5 minutes into this one, Kopitar on a breakaway scores. Kings up with a 1-0 lead early in this one. 8.5 left in the opening frame, Arvidsson gets the rebound on 2-on-1, scores. Kings with a 2-0 start. In the second period, a series of chances for the Devils. First Zetterlund, then Boqvist. New Jersey trying to get that opening goal. Later in the second, Kevin Fiala, the leading scorer for the Kings, has a great chance stopped by Vitek Vanacek. 3 and change left in the second. Tomas Tatar scores. Devils on the board, and Tatar gets his first tally at home since late December. Huge assist by Dawson Mercer. In the third period, it's Mercer's time to shine. He gets a big goal to tie this game at 2 off of a feed from Tomas Tatar. The chemistry with those two on the top line has been outstanding. Under 5 left in regulation, tied at 2. Kopitar to Durzi, who scores. 3-2 Kings lead, but don't count the Devils out quite yet. A great, huge chance in overtime after Nico Hischier did send this to overtime. And then in the final seconds here, Dawson Mercer scores. 4-3 overtime victory for the Devils, who come away with a big 2 points, rebound from poor performance on Tuesday night, and show the Western Conference Kings that the Eastern Conference is quite the challenge so far. Dawson Mercer played his 140th consecutive game to start his NHL career, which ties Scott Gomez's record set in 2001. Mercer has shown he's able to stay healthy and he's able to have an impact when he's on the ice, whether playing on the top line and scoring 2 goals or being a utility piece that can center or be on the wing throughout the entire lineup. Jack Hughes picks up an assist, Nico Hischier picks up a goal, Dougie Hamilton with an assist, Kevin Ball, who returns to the lineup tonight, picks up a helper as one. Plenty of Devils on the score sheet, but the big takeaway, never count the Devils out. This is their 21st comeback win and 7th time this season they've been able to overcome a 2-goal deficit in order to get the W. We're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we expect to hear live from players in the Devils locker room and later on head coach Lindy Ruff. Also from the RWJ Barnabas Devils Hockey Network, we're expecting to have Matt Lachlan and Chico Resch to help break down this huge Devils win.
You know, I look back at the 2003 team, and I sometimes say, and I don't like to compare usually, but I'm gonna. Even though we had a lot of points that year in the regular season, that probably wasn't our best team of the 3 Stanley Cups. We won by stifling defense, just contribution.
What hurt us was didn't respect the game well enough in the first. 2 mistakes that we give up, 2-1s in the breakaway. That's cost us the 2 goals, so but we stick with it, and overall it felt we had more energy today, and it was we kept with the kept with the game plan, and this deserves at the end that win, I think.
Nico, what is it about this team that it just feels like it's never out of it?
We're a good team. We just gotta understand we almost beat ourselves today again, and if you understand that, especially coming down the stretch, if we limit our mistakes, they're going to work harder to get their goals. So we can give them gifts, and then we know, like, we have to scale up front to score some goals.
Is that just sort of what it's about, is sort of plowing away at a game like that, knowing you do have those assets to turn a game around?
Yeah, I mean, it's not a secret. In hockey, it goes fast. Like, 2-0 lead, like 2 goals is nothing in hockey. Like, it can go bang, bang, and it's the back of the net. So you just got to play till the end. And I think we have that in this team, and not just this year. Even like last year, we had a few games that we came back and just never give up. And that's the mentality we need.
I know we've talked a lot recently about Dawson, but again, another night like this from him. I mean, I see that smile again on your face.
Yeah, Same answer, just really happy for him. He works really hard and gets rewarded. So definitely a great game for him and a big part of this win for us tonight.
What did you see, obviously, on the tying goal there?
You know, I was hoping Jack just sends it in front of the net and I got a good little tip on it. And it worked out like I had it in my head. So that's definitely a good thing, I guess.
Thanks, Nico.
Good. No problem.
Don't worry, okay. Captain Nico Hischier talking about Dawson Mercer continuing to find success in this one. When he's been on that top line with Hischier and Tomáš Tatar, the three of them have found this instant chemistry. Mercer on a 5-game goal streak. He has 9 points over that time. And another benefit, you now see Tomáš Tatar get a goal of his own tonight. It's his first tally here at Prudential Center since late December. But let's hear from the 2-goal score tonight for Dawson Mercer in the locker room.
Final play there.
Yeah, obviously I was happy to get my name called upon to go out there, and out there are pretty good players like Dougie and Jack, and I know I'm making sure if they have the puck, I want to make sure I get myself open, and Dougie found me, and that one went in the back of the net.
What was that feeling kind of like? You're knowing how this game was at one point, you guys were down 2-0.
Yeah, that was, you know, it was a lot of excitement after, you know, they had a good first period, and we had a few mistakes, and they capitalized on those, and then ended up we pushing back and got it 2-2, and then we ended up having to try to find a way to push it to overtime after, but we stuck with it, we never gave up, and you know, obviously we capped it off there in overtime.
What were the things that allowed you to keep pushing back on this game to get yourselves to a point where you could tie up?
Yeah, I think just our speed. Obviously they're a great defensive team, they're, you know, a good team in general, and I think just our speed and consistent pressure, we kept on going at them and getting chances, and you know, they ended up finding the back of the net, and that really just kept us going, and we used that to our advantage.
So what did you see from Tomáš Tatar on that play where he kind of sneaked in to steal the puck and set you up for the first goal?
Yeah, it was great. Obviously, you know, I seen Tuna going, he was doing a great job on the puck hunting it tonight, and I gave him a little call, and he, you know, he trusted in and he sent it back for me, and I'm happy I didn't mess up on that one.
Did just scratch my back, I scratched yours, because he said you set him up for his goal prior.
Yeah, it was pretty good. Actually, I mentioned that to him on the bench after. I was like, it's pretty much the same thing. Like, we both just hunted, got the puck, and gave it to the other one.
Pretty way, easy way to draw it up then, huh?
Yeah, well, if it's working, it's working.
Dawson, that's 7 goals in 5 games now. I mean, what are you doing different, man? What are you preparing different? How are you doing this?
Yeah, I think just obviously, I'll keep on saying, going back to it, like a lot of my goals are coming from in front of the net besides that one in the high slot, but every other one, I'm right there within 5 feet of the net, and I'm going to make sure I keep going to that area because obviously it's working, and making sure putting pucks on net, obviously if you got to shoot to score, and it's been going good.
You guys come back from being down twice in the game. What does that say about your team as a whole?
Yeah, I think obviously, like you can say, we're never out of it, and we got a talented group in here, a team, you know, that plays with that speed, and like I said, we're never out of the game. I think we can create constant pressure, and you know, obviously when we get so many scoring chances, they finally got us to go in, and I think that really happened there at the end of the game.
How do you sort of clean that up so that you don't find yourselves down?
Yeah, obviously we don't want to get in that situation a lot.
For Dawson Mercer, after the Devils come back and beat the LA Kings 4-3 in overtime, Mercer had 2 goals tonight. He also picked up a helper on Tomáš Tatar's goal, and Mercer is just finding his speed, his rhythm, and he said he just keeps going net front to get those opportunities when Tatar and Hischier are throwing them on net. Let's go back to the locker room where defenseman Jonas Siegenthaler is live.
Great hockey after the first 2 goals they scored on, and I think, you know, we never gave up, and you know, that's Joe character.
What is that like with the confident level, knowing that, you know, this team has had a knack for coming back?
I mean, we know, like, if we play the right way, we're dangerous. You know, we can score if you play fast, if we don't give them any time. But we just got to do it. You know, we got to play our game and, you know, execute the right way. And if we do that, you know, we know we're a dangerous team.
What does it feel like when Vanacek back there, you know, kind of knowing that you gave up that late goal, but he's there, he's been a rock for you?
Yeah, I mean, he's, you know, ever since he got to Jersey, I feel like he's been unbelievable. You know, he's, I mean, it's not easy for him, you know, he got scored on 2 goals pretty early. But you know, he just played his game after and never gave up, and you know, just focused on himself, and you know, at the end we got the win.
What was the difference in terms of pushing back after that, after you guys were down 2-0?
You know, we weren't happy, obviously. You know, we came to the locker room first intermission, and we had a quick talk. You know, it's not acceptable to start like this, but you know, at the end, it's we got to give us credit to you know, turn this thing around and you know, score late as well, and you know, get the win in OT, and you know, I think that's that shows what we're capable of.
How valuable is that moment where you guys come back to the locker room down to nothing, you have that conversation with each other, and you actually do it?
Yeah, that's you know, we don't only talk about it, we go out there and do it as well. I think that's the biggest difference this year. You know, we have those talks, we go out there, we execute, and you know, we follow the game plan, and as I said, if we do that, you know, we're a good team.
Thanks.
The Devils pick up a big 4-3 overtime win to beat the LA Kings, and they sweep the season series against their opponent. First winning in LA in January and now winning here at home. Welcome back to your post-game live show presented by Genucel. And I'm very excited to welcome in from RWJ Barnabas Devils Hockey Network, Chico Resch and Matt Lachlan. Gentlemen, when you look at the first period, missed coverage was the reason why the Devils had two goal deficit going into that first intermission. What was the biggest defensive breakdown that we saw there from the Devils at the start?
Same as Montreal.
Exactly, yeah.
It was a repeat of Tuesday, Chico.
It really was, and we're going to show you the goals, but this is not typical of defense, of the Devils' defensive alignment. They're giving these glorious chances. Now, here's Kopitar. Look at how wide open he is, and a great slick move through the five hole, and that wasn't good. Look at this. The Devils just, you know, they were going dead. Like, they weren't aware of what was happening behind them. Just like, you know, against Montreal. They weren't picking up the defenseman there. They didn't pick up the lead guy. And here you see 2-on-1, Mandy. This was after an earlier 2-on-1, remember?
3-on-1.
It was
a 3-on-1, and Arvidsson had the puck right on his stick on the doorstep. Couldn't score, but there he puts the rebound home.
So you're saying, what's going on with the Devils? Now, we got to give L.A. credit. They came out. They were playing hard. But here again, the bad reads, the bad decision-making, however you want to call it. But let's be honest, Catherine, I was starting to worry. I mean, I was. And 2-0 wasn't bad, but I thought, well, they'll get it going the second. The Devils will get it going in the second, and that didn't happen early either.
No, it took a while. There was a shot of Lindy Ruff after the Kopitar goal, and he mouthed the words, "Oh, come on," because that's what they talked about this morning. There was no practice yesterday. He wanted the team to get some energy, and they talked about it. They talked about it this morning. They showed video. This is where our coverage was lacking last game, yeah. And it happens right at the start.
Well, Catherine, I don't want to hear us talking about got to play 60 minutes. No team plays 60 minutes. You know what? L.A. didn't play 60 minutes. That's why they got beat. But they had a heck of a first 45 minutes. Devils didn't have a very good 30 minutes to start the game, but they came on. And the other thing was, I just want to go over Jack Hughes's. I got to tell you, his first two periods weren't good. At the end of the second period, after he gave the puck away, I watched him. He raced to the door that lets the players out into the dressing room area, and then he ran down the hall. He was so upset with himself. But as we'll see later, who set up Heischer for the big goal? Jack Hughes. And so that's the kind of game hockey can be. You don't usually play 60, but you got to find a way to win at the right time, and the Devils did it again.
62 and a half minutes
well,
tonight
that's right.
For the New Jersey Devils as they win in overtime. And to your point about Jack Hughes, the great players, all they need is one opportunity. Yeah. It wasn't his best game. He's been off since his return. He's picking up assists, you know, helps out big time on the Heischer tying goal near the end of the game, but has been trying to do too much, going through 2-3 guys, turning the puck over, whatever's happening. But then in overtime, he was so dynamic, so dynamic. So now the Devils crawl back into it. Tomas Tatar and Dawson Mercer, they got a little mojo going. Let's first talk about and take a look at Tomas Tatar's goal, which he continues to play very well. Actually, you know what? Why don't we hear from Tomas Tatar, who's live in the dressing room?
I mean, you know, I'm just trying to help the team, you know, to do good things, you know, on the ice. I think our line is clicking, you know, we're doing a lot of positive stuff out there, and I'm glad it showed on scoring tonight, and we could help the team this way.
One of the things that Siegs was saying is that after the first period, you guys came in here and said, just not acceptable the way things went. What does it mean to a team when you can say those things in a room and then go ahead and change it on the ice? That doesn't always happen.
Yeah, you know, I think it showed a lot of character. You know, even at the end, you know, they scored another goal and we stick with it and then tie the game. I mean, the first period, you know, the goals what they scored were too easy. You know, we handed to them, and I don't think we played a bad period. We just, you know, didn't respect the game enough, and they scored, you know, two easy goals. It shouldn't happen to us, and it's tough in this league, you know, coming from two goal deficit. But I mean, we showed a character, we did it, but you know, it would be nice, you know, to lead.
When you say we didn't respect the game enough, what does that mean to you, right?
You know, we did too many turnovers, you know, we lost too many pucks, you know, we gave them a breakaway, you know, they went 3-on-1, 3-on-2, so a lot of outnumber rushes, and it shouldn't happen, you know. If you ever won a game, you know, that's already enough, and it all happened within 20 minutes, so we knew what we did wrong, and we've talked about it here in the locker room, and, you know, we come a lot stronger, you know, and I think we played great hockey for 40 minutes.
I think it was the first goal where you were caught on camera kind of encouraging your teammates, whether it was on the bench or right in front of the bench. Do you remember what he was saying there to get everybody charged up?
Not really, to be honest. I mean, I'm trying to be positive, you know, on a bench and, you know, try create a certain spark. Because like I said, you know, I felt like, you know, we have the legs, we have the energy tonight, and it would be, you know, a game out of a window if we didn't try, you know, battle back, and we did, and, you know, wins like this, you know, taste great, so, you know, great job by everyone, you know, we rolled four lines again, you know, everybody did their part, and, you know, that's why we were successful tonight.
It seems like they did a pretty good job of containing you guys on the power play. What do you think's going on there?
I think they're very high, you know, their PK, and they did a good job. I mean, we still have one extra guy, you know, we have to do a better job. It's on everybody on the power play. We couldn't, you know, execute the break-in, you know, to the zone. We'll talk about it. We have to be better, you know. I don't think we did enough. You know, we create a, you know, a lot of opportunity, you know, to have a chance to score on a power play, but, you know, we didn't capitalize on it.
If you watched our pregame show, you would have known that Tomáš Tatar was going to score tonight because he was our Devil in Focus presented by Nerd Focus. He hadn't scored at home since late December. His last goal was against the Minnesota Wild, and before that, he did score in January against the Kings out in LA. So he was due for one here at home, especially with how well that top line was working with Dawson Mercer and Nico Hischier. Chico, something that really made a difference in this game was how engaged the crowd got with this game. Once Mercer and Tatar both added their goals in the second and third periods, what did you see about the atmosphere really helping this Devils team come back for another win?
Well, you know, it was quiet, Matt. There wasn't a lot of energy. Talking to the fans in between periods, they were discouraged. What are we doing? Why can't we score? And so you needed someone to really ignite it. And it was late in the second period when, again, we cannot underestimate what Nico Hischier does on this goal, Matty. You and I talked about it, and you can describe it if Blaine has it up. It's a play behind the net. It looks like
Dawson Mercer. You said Nico Hischier.
Oh, I'm sorry, Dawson Mercer.
Just made a great play, taking it away from Walker. And then what he does after he gets the puck in front is even more impressive. So we'll have the goal that Tomáš Tatar's goal. That gets the Devils on the comeback trail.
Okay, we're a little, can take her back a little bit farther, please, Blaine. Okay, now this looks like, look at the Kings, the white jersey. All got it covered, right? Nothing good's gonna happen. But right here, look at Dawson Mercer. He's gotta beat that guy. So he gets that. Now that's Tatar to your left coming up. But watch what Dawson does. So he's gonna bring it out. Now watch, he stops. See how he picked that defenseman, knocked him down. Because that guy was gonna get on Tomáš Tatar. Mm-hmm. But so Mercer, doing it physically here. Look at that little toe drag through the stick. Now watch here. And he's holding him back. And the other thing was, you can't really see it there, but Dawson didn't really try this. But when he gave the puck to Tomáš Tatar, the puck, you know, the puck's flat on the ice. But when it goes on its edge and it gets on a stick, it's easier to throw it up than when it's flat. That's the other thing that happened for Thomas. And like you said, it was long overdue. You know, he is so lively and energized on the ice, everything he does. And you know, the other thing is, and we don't know what's going to happen in the trade department, but we need two lines going. And now that line, Hischier, Tatar, and Mercer, that can challenge that other line for being the go-to line each and every night.
Yeah, Mercer's been fabulous. Tatar's been terrific this year. Really good year for him. Last year, 15 goals, 30 points. He's exceeded both of those this season already with 20-something games still to be played. I like the fact, I got to ask him tomorrow when I see him, who was he pointing to in the stands after he scored? That's the area where the players' friends stay. And just wonder if somebody was visiting him from Slovakia, maybe.
Let's hope it was his dad. Because Thomas was telling Maddie and I, because his dad coached him a little bit in tennis, but he said, my dad was so hard on me, so hard on me. And I had a brother that I was always competing with, and they were hard on me. But it really toughened him up, and he's thankful that his dad did show that kind of... I've noticed with Europeans, especially back in the day, Czech fathers coming out of, like, the communist era, they were really tough on their kids in any sport. And there was no wiggling around, you know, for the kid to make excuses, and Thomas certainly wasn't that. But let's hope it was his dad, because, boy, that would have been a goal that his dad would have been very proud of his son of.
And Dawson Mercer doing the work in front, that's where he's had his success lately. He's been around the net. He's not playing a perimeter game. He goes to what they call the dirty area, not as dirty as it was 35 years ago, because you'd be black and blue if you spent much time there. But still, it's a hard area because you're in tight. There's a lot of sticks, bodies around. You got to find a way to do something, and he has.
Okay, that's a great lead-in. Let's go to Mercer's goal. And now Thomas Tatar said, hey, buddy, you really helped me, Dawson, score a goal. I'm going to return the favor. And you're going to see what Thomas Tatar does on this dump-in by Kevin Ball. Like, you got to take it back because, oh, we got to go back. Okay, now watch this. And Kevin Ball's playing well, okay? Just a simple breakout. Here we go. Kevin says, okay, I'm going to hammer this around. Now watch Tatar here. He sticks a stick into the feet and stick of the defender, the rookie, got the puck, takes it to his skate, and then look at that layup. And Dawson Mercer flings it in. And, you know, there were five other chances for Devils to score. Yes, he's going to those areas, Matty. Yes, he's shooting the puck, but he's shooting the puck with accuracy. Remember how I always tell you? Because Jack Hughes had a shot like that. He didn't score. Don't get me wrong. I'm saying the accuracy was counts. And, boy, I haven't seen Dawson Mercer hitting the spots like he is now.
Because he put a shot off the top of the crossbar earlier. And was that just before Kopitar's goal or Arvidsson's?
Yeah, just before Arvidsson's.
Just before Arvidsson. So just miss, they score, put it below the bar.
There you go. That's a kid that learns in a hurry.
Well, listen, I've been listening a long time to you, my friend.
The last time the Devils and Kings played in January, LA was actually, before we get to this point, we have Devils head coach Lindy Ruff live at the podium. Let's listen to the bench boss.
Well, you know, I think we've had a great tendency to deal with adversity and hunker down and overcome, you know, bad plays. And so, you know, to come back from 2-0, they're a tough team to generate chances. They're a very well-structured team. Got to give our guys a lot of credit.
How is the, Dawson's game right now? It seems he's red hot. What do you attribute it all to?
Well, you know, I think that when you get momentum as a player and all of a sudden, you know, we've seen it with other players, we've seen it with other guys in the team, and puck starts going to the net, a lot of times it goes in from a lot of different directions, and, you know, he's had a lot of goals around the net. Tonight, again, around the net, and then the overtime goal drove hard, and Dougie made a great play and, you know, finds that small hole between the legs and wins us a game.
You usually say, well, I like, you know, even though whatever the score is, I like the way we were playing early, or I didn't like, but what changed?
I liked our first period, except for two shifts. We worked hard. The detail on the breakaway goal was poor, and that was our hero of the game. That was a Dawson's play. I mean, it was a play where he needed to back up our defenseman. And then we gave up, you know, a 3-1 and a 2-1, and that I told him in between periods, that's last year's hockey. That's not this year's hockey. You know, to give that team rush chances, to give their top line, to give Kopitar's breakaway, details weren't good by the group that was on the ice.
What is it, talking to Jonas in the locker room and Thomas Tatar, they said, you know, after the first period as a group, they said, we can't play like that. We've got to turn this around. When a team can have that conversation amongst their peers and actually do it, what does that mean for the growth and development of a group? Because it doesn't always happen that way.
Well, it means they understand that the way they're playing isn't going to be good enough to win. That, you know, this stretch we're going to go through is going to be a very difficult stretch, and we're going to play a lot of good teams, and there really is no easy game, so you have to maintain a high level of play. We made a decision to start the year that, you know, we need to eliminate a lot of the type of chances we gave up in the first period. You know, probably three grade A chances. The 3-on-1 didn't turn into a chance. The 2-on-1 turned into a goal. Breakaway was a goal. Those were the types of situations that we really stayed away from early in the year. And, you know, although I liked all our energy and I liked the way we skated, and I think that day off really refreshed them. For a little bit, we didn't have anything between the ears.
On the same note as Dawson Mercer, what are you seeing from Thomas Tatar's play right now? He seems just like a motor out there and working on every single shift.
Yeah, you know, he's given us everything he has. And, you know, I think he relishes the opportunity to be in big games and score big goals and get big opportunities. And, you know, I think in his career, probably he wouldn't be the guy that would go over the bench in that last 40 seconds before overtime. You know, I think he understands that play away from the puck is really important. But when he gets a chance offensively, you know, he's really trying to make a difference.
Lindy, obviously injuries limited him last season, but this year Hamilton has really taken it to another level. What have you seen from him? Obviously, offensively, he's so strong, but defensively as well, what he's able to do.
Yeah, you know, I think first defensively, I think the chemistry that he's had for, you know, 90% of the year with Siegenthaler has been a big plus. I think the fact, again, you mentioned the injury really set him back, confidence-wise, play-wise, and, you know, I think with the number of goals that were going last year, that, you know, with some of our goalie struggles, you know, I think some of the confidence of a lot of players was at a low, and I think he was one of them.
Lindy, you give up a goal with 4 minutes to go in the game. A lot of teams might get deflated, but can you talk about the two goals you scored, the one at the end and then one in overtime, the skill that it took to score those goals?
Yeah, I mean, if you look at you look at the play, I thought Doug made a great play keeping the puck alive at the blue line. You know, that might end the game if it gets over the blue line. Nico's position in front of the net, you know, kind of Jack's awareness to kind of look off Nico and then make that play. And really to, you know, deflect it to a very small area. It was a huge goal for us. You know, especially with giving up the one we didn't want to give up.
Lindy, there's obviously a lot of activity going on in the Eastern Conference, teams gearing up for the playoffs. Does that make you feel like you guys need to do the same thing too, transaction-wise, you know, seeing all these teams that you're probably going to face moving forward in a playoff series, you know, add?
You know, we're just focused on winning games right now. Obviously, there's stuff that goes on this time of year, and it'll continue to go on until we get by the deadline. We have a lot of really good young players that are playing well for us and helping us provide the W's that are a big part of this team right now.
Thank you, Lindy.
Devils bench boss Lindy Ruff following his team's 4-3 overtime win against the LA Kings. Now, this wouldn't have been possible without Dawson Mercer continuing his goal streak. He's now at 5 straight games, 7 goals over that time, and 9 total points. So the forward in his sophomore season showing a lot of promise, showing that when he's with Tomáš Tatar and Nico Hischier on that top line, they can find true success. Tomáš Tatar also added a goal and an assist in this performance. And, of course, You wouldn't have gone to overtime if it wasn't for the captain, Nico Hischier, scoring with less than a minute left to send this game and at least pick up 1 point against the Kings. So let's break down that game-tying goal late in the third period. And I'm going to throw it over to you, Chico and Matt, because I want you to break down how this goal was even possible in order for the Devils to really cement this comeback.
Well, first off, you have to fall behind by a goal with about 4 minutes to go. And I wasn't sure that there was a comeback in the offing. I thought there was an understandable deflation on the Devils' part, but they kept at it. Give them a lot of credit. And this was just, as Lindy said, good work by Dougie keeping it alive at the blue line. And then Jack Hughes just doing Jack Hughes-like things.
And the crowd is hollering. Shoot, shoot. Even like before Dougie got it up there, the crowd said shoot. And yeah. I thought, yeah, but they put it down deep. And if we could stop coming up right here. You see that stick in the middle of your screen? Coaches will say, give your teammate a target. Now look at the stick is bent back. Hischier's already got it in a position to tip it in. But Jack Hughes there has got to put it right on his stick. I mean, what a gorgeous pass. What a great play by Hischier. And what do we or the crowd know? We're yelling, shoot, shoot. Jack says, I got a better idea.
Yeah.
Nico goes in front, and I'll just drill it off his stick and into the net.
And he was able to get the position on Durzi, who had scored the go-ahead goal. And there was Palat backdoor, so if that puck somehow gets through, there's another supporting character there. And then this was just a beautiful give-and-go to win the game.
And I want to see, like, Copley's played really well. This is not to take anything away from Dawson Mercer, but if we can show the goalie, only because I made this mistake. This is what I'm saying, playing 60 minutes. The goalie is deceived here. What? See where his stick is? It's not even between his legs. Maybe he thought Dougie was going to shoot it. I don't know, but when a goalie gives you that much room, Dawson Mercer's going to say, thank you very much. I can deflect this through that 3 feet of net.
And but, this is an awesome pass, too.
Oh, awesome pass. And I mean, it was like they dominated, right, the whole overtime,
oh,
Maddie.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't even think the Kings got an opportunity.
And Fiala's stick is on the wrong side.
Yeah.
His stick is on the outside, so that left that lane open. Dougie had to thread the needle, but left the lane open. So a couple of mistakes there. You often say, one mistake, okay. Two mistakes, no good. And there were two mistakes on that play. One by Fiala, the other by Copley.
It's no good when your team makes them. But when the other team makes them, it's good. And tonight, it was good.
Yeah, and the crowd, just the woos as we were leaving, making our way up here, were incredible, ringing throughout the building.
Oh, the expectation is so high. After the first period, the crowd, I'm talking to them, they're so down. What are we doing? Well, you know, we can't start to falter. I mean, it's almost life and death, but that's where we put them. The Devils have put their fans on. I really think they think they're going to go deep in the playoffs. I think so, too.
And they might. They're talented. They've got the determination on their side. They don't get down too far on the scoreboard. When they do, they can come back. But I do want to point out something that we discussed, Catherine, on our pregame show. So what made this an important game near the end of February? You know, yeah, bounce back. Let's see what you got. We know what the Devils have. It was good that they showed it. It took some extra time. But let's face it, catching Carolina is going to be hard.
Yep.
They're 3 points behind them now, but they opened up some room tonight on the Rangers. The Rangers lost in Detroit. The Devils win here, so now they're up 6 on the Rangers. It really is a battle right now for second and third, and you want the home ice advantage against your rivals.
Absolutely, Matty, and I don't think the Devils are looking necessarily forward or back. I was talking about that. If you're a good pro, you live in the moment. You don't, like Lindy said, we don't look back at the last game against Montreal. We don't look ahead to the next game against Philly. It's just the moment, and the Devils are doing a good job of living in the moment. But here, I'll throw something out to you two. You know, I'll be so happy when the trading deadline comes because everybody's got speculation.
Well, you know, you're rumored to be on the move for a second-round draft pick. I'm trying to hold down and keep you as my partner.
Well, thank you. And Blaine, our producer, said, yeah, we're trying to change you for a new chair. How bad is that? I'll get you after. But here's the thing. We're Devils fans, and I'm asking you, Devil fans, would you make the trade at the cost of giving up one of the Devils' key players. We've heard of Dawson Mercer being there. I'm just saying, you're not going to get Timo Meier unless you give up a really good player and some draft picks. So now I'm starting to think, maybe we just leave it alone. Maybe some minor deal and not mess with the chemistry. That's just my opinion. I don't know, Catherine, if you want to go there, you probably don't. Come on, Catherine, no? Okay.
I'm good. I will not speculate. I'll okay. see what happens on March 3rd.
All right.
Okay. I do have one more point I want to bring up about the Devils. Often this team is credited for being a great overtime team because they have fast forwards who have great hockey sense and can really make a lot of high skill plays to win this game. But put some respect on the Devils' 6-on-5 play, because with their sixth goal tonight in that situation, they now tie the Detroit Red Wings for the most in the NHL. That's something that New Jersey has really focused on in practices, making sure anytime they're pulling the goalie, they have to play really strong in their own zone, because if that puck gets out of the zone, it's a really good opportunity for the other team to take away any air in the sails for the Devils to come back and win this one. When you look at the 6-on-5 play tonight, of course, it led to the Nico Hischier tying goal. But what have you both seen out of the Devils being able to capitalize so late in the game to get those 21 comeback victories this season?
Well, you know, you make a very good point, because last year it seemed when they pulled the goalie, there was an empty net goal scored against. So I would just say, what, more determination, board battles?
I think hockey awareness. You know, we've got way more hockey sense skilled players than we realize. Like Dougie Hamilton here. Why does he decide to play this down? He could have shot. He could have went back. You know, in 3-on-3, our hockey sense, the Devils' hockey sense was so superior. There's the tying goal to L.A. And, of course, the Devils practice it. We got really good coaches that are going over 3-on-3. But when it's 3-on-3, the guys that are out there, they are so smart with the puck. They very seldom give it up. What are they, 9-3 now in overtime, Maddie? I think it was 8-3 coming in, the Devils.
9 wins, most in the NHL.
And I got to say, folks, that's hockey sense with skill. Look at this skill play. This is the same one. I thought this was the overtime. It is the overtime.
It is the overtime, yeah.
But how about that for skill and awareness? I mean, we are a very special team because of the hockey sense that so many of our players have.
Well, the Devils will celebrate their 20-year anniversary of the 2003 Stanley Cup Championship on Saturday as New Jersey hosts the Philadelphia Flyers. Many members of that team and support staff are already in the building and will be in the building on Saturday. So, Matt and Chico, when you think back to that third Stanley Cup victory in franchise history, what are some of your favorite memories that come up from that time?
Well, I think, of course, you know, you got to think about Mike Grubb giving the Devils the 1-0 lead with the game-winning goal in Game 7 against Anaheim. But I think upsetting Ottawa, which was the best team in the league points-wise that year, and Jeff Friesen's goal late after he had made a mistake that cost the Devils earlier in that game, that'll stand out to me just simply because he was so... It speaks about the beauty of sports. You just never know. You're the GOAT 1 minute, you're the hero the next. And that was Jeff Friesen.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And Ottawa, I think, was a better team than the Ducks that year. Wasn't it also in that Ducks series where Marty Brodeur dropped his stick?
Oh, yeah.
And the goal went in? It was a Game 3, Catherine? Yeah, so even though I thought the Devils won Game 7 pretty convincingly, I mean, they dominated. Mm-hmm. But to get to that point, it could have went either way. And I think you're right. When Jeff Friesen scored that goal, to me, it said, the magic is there, and this team is a team of destiny, and that's what it turned out to be.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. Ken Danico's playoff streak comes to an end.
Oh, yeah.
In a blistering argument with Pat Burns.
Remember that? That was in Boston.
That was in Boston.
I remember Dano, because we were there doing the TV, and Dano got Pat Burns, I think it was on the concourse or whatever.
Yeah.
Remember? And, oh, he was just giving it to him, and Pat Burns, he could fight back. He understood what was going on there, benching Kenny Danico. But there were some twists and turns that you didn't know which way that playoff was going to go.
Yeah, and then he puts Kenny in for the final game after sitting him out for a good portion of the final stretch of the playoffs there. And decides that we need you coming back for Game 7 at home after losing Game 6 in Anaheim. So there was that. There was the series win over Boston. There was just a lot of good memories. Marty Brodeur was brilliant in that final round particularly, but brilliant throughout the playoffs. But Jean-Sebastien Jaguar, Anaheim doesn't get there if he doesn't play the way he did against Detroit. And I know Devils fans rightfully are saying Brodeur should have been the Conn Smythe Trophy winner. And in many ways, he should have been. But Jaguar was incredible. Paul Kariya getting knocked out and coming back. If he gets knocked out like that today, he doesn't play for another month. And I'm not saying...
And maybe Scott Stevens doesn't either because he gets suspended or something.
I mean, I'm not saying that that wouldn't be the smart play, but, you know, I think Paul Kariya is dead on the ice. He's out. And then that puff of air, remember that puff of air into his shield? And you're like, oof, no bueno. And then, but he comes back and he plays and he wins the game.
Well, I think, too, it was the end of an era. It was the end of the, like, hard-hitting... I can knock you out type of play if it's clean. The players, especially Scott Stevens, could get away with. You're not going to see that anymore, but that had a lot of twists and turns. And who would have thought, Catherine and Maddie, that we wouldn't see a cup after that? I thought that team had a shot at least winning another one or two, because we thought they could have won the year before against Colorado, you know, a year or two before, yeah. I'm not sure. But I never thought that, you know, we'd be waiting this long, 20 years, for the next cup to come along.
Yeah, you got to celebrate them. What do players say? I mean, and you know, having won a cup, some guys, they come into the league and in their first year, second year, they win a cup. They think, God, this is the way it's supposed to be. Then they go a long time before they get a chance at another one. They realize how hard it is. The Devils certainly earned their three cups. They had a couple of near misses there starting in 94 and 2001. But you take the three.
And, you know, that was the last year of Meadowlands, or near the last
near
year.
The end. Yeah, it wasn't quite.
You know, and we're all hoping that we love this new building, the Prudential Center, Catherine. But you know, it doesn't become special until somebody with the Devils is hoisting that cup. And if it's not this year, I think within the next couple of years, I don't know if you guys agree, this team will have a shot at doing that again.
Yeah, they're on the rise and the move to where they were when they were considered a threat each and every year. There's no doubt about that.
There's plenty of content with former members of that 2003 team up on NewJerseyDevils.com, so make sure you check it out. And if you're coming to the game on Saturday, make sure you're in your seat a little bit early. We suggest 6:45 so you can see the full pregame ceremony involving management, players, and coaches from that third and final Stanley Cup championship for now with the Devils franchise. Chico, Matt, thank you as always for all of your analysis and breakdowns. Kyle McKenna, James Lipscomb, thank you always for your great information and stats. And make sure you keep it locked in on NewJerseyDevils.com as the Devils are really fighting for a playoff spot in the final stretch of the season. For your post-game show presented by Genucel and Matt Lachlan, Chico Resch, I'm Catherine Bogart. Have a great night.
Shake it. Shake It.